Today is Wednesday, April 26, 2023. My name is Grace Park, and I'm here with Rita Ajit, and we're interviewing Dr. Crystal Shin on behalf of the Houston Asian American Archive at Rice University.
So thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to speak with us and share your story. So I'm going to begin with the first section of the interview, and then Grace is going to take over for the second part. So just to begin with your early life, can you tell us when and where you were born?
Sure. I was born in Koje Island in South Korea. It's a southeast part of South Korea. It's an island that's not too far away from the mainland, so there's a bridge. So you can get to the island by driving. And I was born in 1985. January 25.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us what it was like, what your family dynamics were like in your household growing up?
Sure. I have two younger sisters. We're 2 years apart. So 2 years younger and 4 years younger. So it was very active. Lots of screaming, but in a fun way. I think we were very musical. Like, we like to sing together and we played instruments. And my parents, there were my mom, my dad was working full time, and my mom was the house mom or housewife, but she was very active in her own activities. So I remember she was taking guitar classes, so she had like recitals and stuff when I was growing up, and she was part of the choir. So she did a lot of activities, but she was there, she was at home when we were home. And growing up, we took a lot of road trips, family road trips, if not every weekend, like at least every other weekend, we would, you know, drive. And this was when we went to school on Saturdays. I mean, it was a half day, but went to school on Saturdays, and my dad worked on Saturdays. So whenever he would come home around noon, 1 o'clock, my mom would have us ready, and we'll just, you know, hit the road, drive 3 or 4 hours, end up somewhere in the middle of nowhere, like in the mountains. And yeah, we would go on the road trips like that. So I mean, it was a very fun, I only have fun loving memories.
Mm-hmm. That sounds like a really nice childhood. Your dad,
yeah.
What was his work?
He was a clinical pharmacist, so he was overseeing all operations in a hospital. In pharmacy.
Mm-hmm. So what were some important values or lessons that your parents instilled in you?
So my dad used to say to do your best, like whatever it is, just give the best as you could. So I think that was I mean, growing up, it was just, it sounded cliche, but as an adult, I think that was good value. Whether I practiced or not, that's a different story. But yeah, I think that was a good message. And my mom, she, you know, I think she, so we grew up as Buddhist. So, you know, Buddhist household, we talk about karma, you know, why I think my mom really emphasized us being kind to other people and just, you know, be a nice human being.
So I know you talked a little bit about your tradition of these little road trips with your families, but besides that, were there any other big family traditions or holidays that you guys love to celebrate?
I guess, when I was in Korea, it was just, you know, whenever we have breaks. But now in the States, my sisters and I, we celebrate the day we first landed. So we
That's
call it our Columbus Day. It's not really the same, but we celebrate that day. And of course just birthdays and yeah, but we don't really have like big family tradition. But when I was in high school, you know, Christmas to New Year's, that was always like a family time.
Yeah, it's nice that you're still so close with your sisters.
Yeah. Some will find it unhealthy, I don't know, but we're very close, you know. We have family chat room as well. We talk to each other. I talk to my parents, you know, every day. I talk to them. They're in Korea now, so the time difference kind of makes it easier for us to talk, because I talk to them during my commute.
Right. So next we're going to talk a little bit about, later we'll talk about schooling a little bit, but what was your favorite subject in school growing up? And were you always interested in science?
I don't think I had a favorite subject that I can say, oh, this was my favorite. I just remember not enjoying it very much. It wasn't, so wait, are we talking about the, you know, schools in Korea or in the US?
I'd like to hear a
in
little bit
college
about Korea
in
first.
Oh yeah, okay. Yeah, no, I don't think I had any favorite subjects, but I had a early exposure to science in elementary school. I was fourth grade. That's when we moved from the island to the mainland, Korea, outside of Seoul. So I lived in a suburb called Suwon, which is the capital of that region, or that district. No, what, I forgot what's the proper not province, but yeah, that area. So it's not a small town. It's a decent sized town. And my dad was relocated there. That's why we moved. And I was in an elementary school that was fairly new. And they were just starting. I think I was the third graduating class. So it was really new school. And they started this program, like Boy Scouts, Girl Scout. They had those. And I believe it's called Youth Astronauts of Korea or something like that. Some organizations that you know, that I was very lucky to be part of. I've always wanted to be the brownie girl because I thought the uniform was the cutest thing.
I agree.
Then when I heard about this, it was very interesting because we had to take the test to get into this youth astronaut program. It wasn't like a hard test. It was more of a, in retrospect, now that I think about it, it was more like how this person is thinking, you know? So I took the test. I actually got in. There were people who didn't make it. So, you know, I was really excited about that. But that program gave me all the exposure because I was very fortunate to have passionate teachers who really cared about science. So every day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, sometimes we didn't have any activities on Wednesdays, but Thursday and Friday, we always had some after school activities. We did group projects to build like miniature rockets and water powered rockets. And we did like simple scientific experiments. And we learn how to write a scientific report. And we did some like solving math problems together, things like that we did. And I went to, you know, summer camp with a group and winter camp where we meet other students from different places in Korea. So I really enjoyed that. At that time, I was just having fun. You know, I was with my friends, we were building things, which was super cool. And, you know, these rockets, we made it from plastic bowling pin. You know, those, it's a kid's toy, right? So we're like repurposing the toy to build rockets out of it. So it was super fun. Then, you know, later on, now that I'm older, I think that might have really, that's what instilled like my interest in science at the time. And then I've always thought that I would do something science related.
Yeah. It's so cool to trace that spark back to when you were a kid.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we wanted to talk a little bit.
It was really fun.
Yeah. So we want to talk a little bit about your immigration story and how you came from South Korea to the United States. So when did you make that decision to make the big move?
So it was really my parents who who agreed or decided that it was okay for us to relocate. So I wanted to study abroad. When I was like 13. So I was just angry teenager asking my parents to send me away because I didn't like my schools, I didn't like my teachers, I didn't understand why I had to take 14 subjects to, you know, and then I was just tired of hearing, oh, your next 6 years, like 3-4 years of your life can really benefit your life for the rest of your life. Like, I just didn't get that concept. And then again, I was an angry teenager. So I would, you know, ask my parents to send me away. Then my mom said, no, I can't have you as a teenage girl alone in foreign country. Then we had a breakthrough, I guess. My mom met her friend from her classmates from high school who was living in Virginia at the time. So they were talking. My mom was, you know, she told her friend about me wanting to, you know, going away, was studying abroad. Then one thing led to another. She figured that it would be better for, I mean, she's got two other kids too, right? And things in Korea were getting expensive in terms of like education. You know, people spend a lot of money on education, not just school, you know, there are so many after school things that I was doing at the time. I had private tutors and I was still going to, you know, after school places. I don't even know what's the right term. I don't know. Grace, do you happen to know what it's called in English?
Is it
Hagwon?
Referring to Hagwon, right? I would say like academy centers or something. I'm not too sure.
Yeah, after school academy. Yeah. So I was doing all of that. Then just when I was graduating from middle school, my dad said, yeah, maybe you guys should go, because he, you know, he didn't want to start his life over in a foreign country. I mean, he had a very good job, stable career there, so he was in Korea. And then my mom brought three girls with her, and then we settled in Virginia.
Mm-hmm. That's cool to hear, because I'm from Virginia.
So that was 2000.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 2000.
So when you came to the United States, what was that transition like? And were there any really striking differences between the culture?
I mean, really, not Nothing. Except for the language barrier, you know? I felt like I wasn't smart enough. That's really how I felt at the time. I felt dumb, not being able to know what other people are saying, you know? I hear things, but I couldn't really understand what they're saying, and I couldn't express myself well. So that was frustrating. But you know, I mean, I was trying to learn a new language, and what I learned, we learned English in Korea, but it's, you know, completely useless when it comes to having conversation with people. So besides that, I didn't particularly experience cultural differences, because outside of DC, that's where we were, Northern Virginia, it's a very diverse. There were plenty of Koreans, and you know, I hardly experienced any cultural differences. I loved it. I loved going to high school. I mean, I came home at 2:30 p.m. Like I used to come home at 11 p.m. in
Right.
Korea,
With all the
but I was
programming.
home at 2:30, and I played flute since I was in fifth grade, and we're just I was part of a band, and I did marching band, so all these things were just fun because it's not something I never thought I would experience in Korea. So I really enjoyed my high school.
That sounds like an exciting time. But then after you moved to Fairfax, Virginia, I know you've moved around a lot in the US since then. So can you tell us a little bit about where else you've lived?
From Fairfax, I went to high school there. Then I decided to go to college in Indiana. So I lived in West Lafayette, Indiana. That's where Purdue University is. So I lived there for 4 years. I got after a bachelor's, I got a job in Indianapolis. So I lived there for a year. But my mom and my sisters were in West Lafayette. My sisters were at Purdue as well. So I moved back. Then I decided to go to grad school at Purdue. Then after PhD, I came to Houston.
So I know you found a lot of community, you said, in Virginia with other Asian Americans, but did you find difficulties finding community in other cities? How would you say the Asian American community in Houston is in comparison with other cities that you've lived in?
Oh, yeah. So I told you I didn't really experience cultural difference when I moved from Korea to Fairfax. The cultural shock that I had from, you know, moving from Virginia to Indiana was huge. That's when I really experienced the cultural shock. It was nothing like Fairfax, because I truly believe that anywhere in the US would be like Fairfax, Virginia. So when I went to Indiana, that was shocking. There was not, I mean, the state itself is wasn't very diverse, but Purdue campus was diverse. We had a lot of students from all over the world, really. And there was a big Asian community as well. My freshman year, I went to Korean American Student Association meeting once. Then I realized, oh, it's not my thing. They were very, very structured. And I think how they wanted to run the organization was similar to Korean, like a very rigid. Like they would address each other with honorifics that I wasn't familiar with. So after that meeting, I decided not to pursue. But I, you know, in Houston, Houston is also, you know, very diverse. and a lot of different, I mean, even within Asian community, you know, there's a big Indian population and Chinese, Vietnamese, Koreans. So I think I, especially now I'm part of Korean Association, like I'm part of Korean American Scientists and Engineers Association and Korean American Women in Science and Engineering. So those, I think we have very supporting associations that are available for Koreans.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not just Koreans, but, you know, Asians in general, any minority groups.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I also lived in Fairfax County, Virginia, and then came to Houston. So I've also seen how vibrant those Asian American communities are in both cities or areas.
Yeah. Where in Fairfax?
Reston
County. Reston, okay. Yeah.
I love it there.
Reston, Virginia. Ah, so then which high school did you go to high school there?
Yeah, I went to South Lakes High School.
Oh, I went to Fairfax.
Oh, cool. Yeah. We were there for like choir concerts sometimes. I remember we would go.
We had a very nice auditorium.
Yes, that's why we went. Yeah.
Yeah. For a high school, I mean, I thought it was pretty cool.
It was a great high school. Yeah. So with all these different cities and places you've lived in, is there one that you would call home now?
I guess I would say Houston, but Fairfax is, that's my, you know, home in the US, because that's the first place I lived in, you know, that's home. But now I guess I think Houston's my home. I've been here for 9 years now.
Mm-hmm.
And it grew on me.
I'm glad to hear that. So now, okay, we're kind of going back to college, but you have a Bachelor of Science in Food Science from Purdue University. So how'd you become interested in pursuing this major specifically?
I didn't plan on it. I started as a biology major, and I wanted to go to pharmacy school to be a pharmacist like my dad. Pharmacy program, it's a professional school, right? But you can apply to pharmacy school after second year in college. So you don't need bachelor's degree. You could just apply after sophomore year. I did that. I didn't get in. Then I didn't want to do biology.
Mm-hmm.
I was just exploring my options, and I looked at food science. I didn't know it was a major till then. Then really, I didn't have to waste any of my credits. So the prerequisite for pre-pharmacy and, you know, first 2 years of classes you take as a food science major were very similar. So I didn't have to waste any of my credit hours. So I just made the switch.
Right.
It was all about the efficiency for me.
That seems like a great opportunity that just fell into your lap. Yeah.
Yeah, but it was, I'm glad I did that, because it's a very interesting field. It's a very, very interesting, but not very well known. Not many schools apply, offer food science as a major. It's usually schools in the, you know, middle of nowhere.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's part of agriculture.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was part of, food science was part of College of Agriculture. So not many people know about it, but food is everywhere,
mm-hmm.
right? Everything is food science.
Okay.
Even bottled water, coffee, snacks, everything. So as a course, as a major, I think it was great. I learned a lot. You know, I'm that person that reads all the labels in a grocery store aisle. I read it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was a very good subject. Major too.
It's really interesting. It's also the first time I'm kind of hearing about this as a field of study too.
Yeah, and it's a very diverse too, because, you know, my classmates, they ended up working for And then, you know, you never have to worry about the food, the job market, because food industry is always booming. And some of them, they had internship at Gatorade, Frito-Lay, Cargill, even McDonald's. You know, McDonald's at Hamburger University. You know, my friend was like flipping burgers all summer.
Yeah. So interesting. Yeah. So what memories from your college experience have stood out to you and why?
Memories. I had a lot of fun. I loved college as well, and really my friends, people that I met in college, like all of my fond or good memories involved my friends. And Purdue, there's something about Purdue. We have instant bonds. Like, I don't need to know you, but if you're walking outside with a Purdue sweatshirt on, I'll talk to you. We have that instant bond. I don't know whether it's because, you know, Purdue's middle of cornfield. We just shared certain experiences. I don't know. But yeah, like I did get to meet a lot of people from different parts of the world. And that's been really awesome, because now I get to go visit them. And that's how I travel. I go different countries to go to their weddings or just to go visit them.
That sounds so nice. So with these friends that you had, do you have any of them who left a significant impact? Or maybe it could be professors or mentors, just anyone who left a significant impact on your life experiences.
I mean, almost all of my friends made some sort of impact, but I'll have to say my mentors in graduate school. Because even though I went to the same university for my undergrad and my graduate program, the experiences I had were very different. You know, I also had fun as a graduate student, but it was just a different experience. I mean, obviously I was a different person. I was more mature, and I'm glad I got to experience both the sides of the university. But mentors I had in grad school, like, they really shaped my adulthood. I guess when I was an undergrad, it was all about, you know, finding out who I am. But in grad school, I think I learn what it's like to be a real adult. You know, I not just in science, but in life in general. So I my PhD advisor, I learned a lot from him, and I also have a mentor who is the reason why I went to grad school. Like, he's the one that encouraged me to go to grad school.
That's so cool, because the next question I was going to ask was, what made you decide to pursue the PhD? And it was,
yeah, really, that was it. So after working as a food scientist or food technologist, I knew that wasn't my calling. Like, I enjoyed it for a while, but I didn't, that wasn't me. I didn't want to do that. So I was trying to go to pharmacy school again. I thought I would give another shot. You know, I thought that would be really fun to do. And then I was preparing for the applications and stuff. So when I moved back to Purdue, I had an opportunity to work as a research assistant, like a lab tech essentially, at a startup pharmaceutical company that was started by a professor at Purdue. And that's when I really did research, knowing that what I'm doing is research. Then, I mean, throughout my undergrad, I worked at labs, at different labs. I worked in virology lab, horticulture lab, in civil engineering labs. So I was doing things, not really thinking that it's research. I mean, I was undergrad student. I was just doing things what I was told to do. But this was the first time I was, really aware what I was doing, why I'm doing, and I really enjoyed that. So I was, applying to pharmacy schools. I was invited to different schools for an interview. Then I was asked, have you thought of going to grad school? And until then, I never thought I would go to grad school. Getting a PhD wasn't even my option. I just never thought, my dad got his PhD when he was older. Like I was in middle, I was in elementary school when he got his PhD. So I thought PhD was for like old people.
Yeah, but you
So
said
go get yeah, going to grad school was never my intention. I just happened to find research very interesting. I didn't know that it was a viable option for me. But when I had that experience, it's like, oh, I can see myself doing this. It's really fun. I enjoyed doing this. So I still went, for pharmacy school interviews and I got admissions. Then I mean that was important for me to know that when I thought I was going to pharmacy school, I mean that wasn't my focus, but I'm choosing other things not because I didn't have an option, but I choose to do this because I want to. So, well, I'm glad I made the choice.
Yeah, I think those are a great choice in the long run. Yeah, it's nice to see how your interests evolved over time.
Yeah, you never know.
Yeah, you never know where you'll end up. But
Yeah.
were there any barriers you faced pursuing this PhD as a young woman, a minority in STEM? Would you say others were generally supportive?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I didn't face that until I was post until I came to Houston, really. But throughout my PhD, Purdue grad schools are very diverse. There were a lot of international students, a lot of women, especially pharmacy. I think pharmacy is one of the disciplines that have good gender balance. We had a lot of women. So it was, yeah, I mean, everyone was supportive and I'm pretty sure I got some cushions or some protections because I was a student. I was sheltered environment. But yeah, during getting a PhD at Purdue, I didn't experience any.
But you said it was different once you came to Houston.
Yeah, because that's a real world.
Being an adult.
I'm still in school. Right, I work at school, but as a postdoc, that's in especially in a medical center. I think it was a bit different when I first came. It just because I never experienced that. It was a bit shocking when I was automatically, or people automatically thought that I was, a student or I was a nurse. So that was different.
Yeah, so moving on to your career and being out in the real world, as you said. So you started as a food technologist and then became an assistant professor in the surgical oncology division at Baylor. So you've had this wide breadth of scientific jobs. So how do you think your professional interests evolved over time? How did you end up where you are now?
Serendipity, really. I just went with the flow. Follow the current. Really, my career trajectory was not anything I planned. I just, you know. Yeah, really. I was just, you know, minding my own business, doing my own work, and I guess when the opportunity was presented, I just took it.
Yeah, you just followed your interests. I think that's really admirable.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we saw that you have a PhD rather than an MD, but you still kind of work in the medical field. Could you tell us about whether you collaborate with physicians or if your work is mostly in the lab?
Both. I do. So it's interesting because I am a PhD researcher in a clinical department, in a surgery department. I always have to say, I'm not a surgeon. I'm a PhD, a scientist. What I do in this department is, I mean, my background is pharmaceutical science, but my research, my PhD dissertation work was very much biomedical engineering. So I did some tissue engineering. I developed 3D tumor models using hydrogels. So, and I did a little bit of microfluidics with the collaborators. So I'm like leveraging all that information, whatever I learn. And now I'm, you know, we're developing biomaterials for surgical applications, like surgical mesh, hernia mesh, and vascular graft. And, you know, my passion also is developing drug delivery systems. So we're, again, using the biomaterials for drug delivery systems. So that's kind of surgically relevant. It can be used for surgical applications. So that's the research that I do. And I have surgeons who are my collaborators. And I also have other physicians that we collaborate.
I think that's such an interesting field of research. But how do you...
I think so too.
Yeah. How do you divide your time between all this research and teaching and mentoring your students that you have under you?
So I don't teach in a classroom setting. I think we probably have more faculty than students because we don't have undergrad students at Baylor College of Medicine, and we only have graduate programs and MD programs. But I do have students from Rice. Actually, most of my undergrad students, researchers, are from Rice. And I really don't divide my times because it's all part of research. You know, because students are doing their own experiments, they're contributing to the research program that I have.
Was it difficult to build this team that you have of postdocs and grad students and lab techs?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, we as a graduate student, or even as a postdoc, we didn't get that training. When you are a PI, when you have your own lab, it's like running a small company. But we learn how to do science, we learn how to think, but we don't know how to run the company, like how to manage people. So these are the skills that I had to develop. So it took some time to figure out what works for me. Yeah, so there was a steep learning curve.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm getting better at it.
Mm-hmm. And then when COVID struck, was it difficult for your lab to adapt to that?
Oh yeah. Well, first we had to, shut down
right.
the lab. We were not allowed to do any new experiments. And I think a lot of people were, they were just bored too. They wanted to do something, but they couldn't. So we had to kind of come up with a plan. Because we're still getting paid.
Mm-hmm.
So we created like a journal club where we, discuss papers and new ideas. So that took some time to get used to. Then, that didn't last very long because we were slowly, we were able to spend like a few hours a week in the lab. So
mm-hmm.
it wasn't too bad. But initially, just like everyone else, we just had to adapt.
Mm-hmm. How many members of your team are from other countries? And is it difficult to attract international students and team members to this field?
In research, I think it's not hard to recruit international students. I mean, almost all students were born in the US, but they're like a second and third generations of immigrants.
Mm-hmm.
Almost all. No majority, I guess majority. Plus, I'm also international,
mm-hmm.
right? I don't think it's hard for me to recruit international students, but I prefer to have diversity in the lab. So I try to keep that in mind.
Mm-hmm. And would you say like America has like a leading edge in this type of innovation? Do you think that attracts international students?
Yeah, absolutely. I think what's hindering that is the visa processing, because it takes really long time and there's no guarantee. So I think it's really unfortunate that we're not able to recruit like a lot of talents because of that.
Yeah, it seems like such an arbitrary barrier. Yeah. And in terms of funding, do you need to apply for grants and fellowships for your job? And can you tell us a little bit about what that process is like?
Excruciating. No, I mean, it is. It's not fun when you're doing it. We write a lot of grant applications to the federal agency, funding agencies. It's just, there's nothing that's easy.
Mm-hmm.
This is not easy. You're asking a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
And those are the taxpayers' money, right? So you have to put a lot of effort. It's an arduous process. You have to you have to think a lot about things that happened, things that could happen, things that may not happen, but you still have to think about it. But I honestly enjoy it, but I enjoy it more once I'm done because I really feel that that's when I grow. Like I study a lot during that time, so I gain knowledge. So that makes me feel better about myself that I'm like, oh, I feel like I'm smarter.
Yeah, after overcoming all those obstacles, what would you say is the most rewarding part of all of your work?
Just in general, or
Yeah.
about oh, in general, I really like seeing students doing well. My students sound wrong, but students that I work with, when I see them being excited about their result, their work, like that gives me a tremendous happiness. Like it's a very rewarding experience to see that, and then I was able to provide some so they can, experience that. It's very rewarding.
That seems huge. But what about you personally? With so many publications and honors that we've all read about now, what would you say you're most proud of?
None of them.
It's all your students.
None of them. Really, those are. Yeah, it's. I don't know. I honestly don't think much about it. Publications, they make me feel good. Yeah. I'm happy about it, but I but these are they come and go. Because I guess any paper published makes me feel good. Because to get paper published, you have to experience so many rejections. But any work that we were able to make it accessible to other people, I think that's but as a biomedical researcher, whatever we make or we work on in the lab, our goal, our dream would be seeing our materials being used in a clinic. Right? So when I get emails or when someone tells me that what we do in the lab is very valuable, and that we're doing a good work, like that's very rewarding.
Yeah, I think it's that people-to-people connection that sounds so nice to have. And that part doesn't really just come and go like the rest of it. So
That's why we gotta cherish it when it happens.
amazing to hear
Yeah.
about that. Yeah, that's all I have to ask about my section of the interview. So I'm going to pass it over to Grace, but thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
All right. So for my section of the interview, I'm just gonna ask a few questions regarding more of like the cultural identity aspect of your story. So first of all, how would you identify yourself ethnically?
Korean. Korean. That's where I check the box.
Kind of on that spectrum of like Korean American to like American, where do you think you kind of fall? And do you kind of like lean towards one side more or?
Now I mean, I identify myself as Korean American because I have an American passport now. So, but that doesn't really mean much, right? Because when you have this, when you look like this, it doesn't matter what your passport says. But I thought about this a lot. I don't feel Korean enough, and I don't feel American enough. And I'm perfectly fine with it. I'm happy with it. Like I don't need to belong to a certain group.
Right, for sure, yeah. How would you describe the Asian American community in the field of medicine and specifically in the field of surgery or like clinical research?
I can't say I know much about in the medical, I mean in physicians community, because I'm not part of that. But in the scientific community, I think we have I think we generally have a good relationship just among, I mean, like I said, I'm part of Korean American Association, and I know that I have really good colleagues who are from like other Asian countries. But a few years ago, I don't know whether you guys were here for that, but during COVID, we had a Stop Asian Hate rally outside of Baylor, and I was part of that organizing event. But that really brought Asian community together, whether you are Chinese, Korean, Vietnamese, Thai, like it was very heartwarming.
Yeah, for sure.
Witness that, yeah.
So you've mentioned your Korean American Scientists and Engineers Association and also the Korean American Woman in Science and Engineering communities. So could you tell us a little bit more about that, in terms of like how many members are there and like which states do the members represent and kind of like the missions and goals of these organizations?
Whoa, I hope they don't kick me out of that organization after this. I don't know much. No, I'm part of both organizations, not because I have a huge a big mission to make contributions. I mean, really, I was having fun going to these events, and you know, that's how I got involved. And actually, I'm going to be the chapter president starting July for 1 year. So, I mean, even then, I'm, you know, just having fun with fellow Koreans. It's kind of nice to be around the people who speak the same language, who love the same food, who know what's going on, you know, like that's kind of nice. But really, Korean American Scientist and Engineers Association is like huge. It's all over the country, and I believe there are like a couple of thousand, like 2 or 3 thousand members across the country. And in Texas, there are four chapters, one in Austin, one in Rio Grande Valley, one in Austin. No, not Austin, Dallas, North Texas chapter, and then we're South Texas chapter. So that covers Houston area and Texas A&M. We have about, I think we have a couple hundred members. Not just in the medical center, but also people from the oil and gas industry and, you know, energy sector, like all of just in the greater Houston area. And you know, it's really to, you know, have that sense of community. You know, we all have, you know, I mean, we have different backgrounds, but we have similarities, right? Just we have shared culture. So I think it's a good to have that support group, just to really have that sense of community. And that's what I think personally. I'm sure there's, you know, advancing the science and engineering and, you know, supporting the younger generations. I mean, I support that too, but for me, it's really the sense of community. And I think that's important, whatever it is, you know, whether it's a Korean American. And I was part of postdoc association here at Baylor when I was postdoc, and why I joined, like, I needed that sense of community and I wanted to contribute so other people can have the sense of community. So for me, that's very important.
Yeah, I think having that sense of community is definitely very important. So how often are like the meetings or events for these organizations? And could you tell us a little bit more about like what they exactly look like? Is it a lot of like socializing, sharing about scientific works, or?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked. We have a lot of events throughout the year. The most recent one was beginning a few weeks ago. There's a national math and science competition that was supported by the headquarters, you know, KSEA organization. And we had a local, our a chapter had like on-site event where kids come and take math exams, and they, for science, they got to make things. And we do that every year. And we also have like symposiums, a regional conference where we invite faculty. So it's more like a science conference, but for Korean American, but anyone really is welcome to attend. So it gives opportunities for students and postdocs to present their work as well. And starting like 2 years ago, we started the faculty award as well. So we select the top candidates and then give them the award. And that is, you know, from like faculty donation. Each faculty within a TMC, we make donations and do that. And we have a young generation forum. It's more for students and trainees who are interested in their career advancement. So we have, you know, like if you're interested in industry, you know, we invite panels, and you know, it's fun events like that. You could see networking also, right? You get to meet people from different universities. A&M, they come down here for that event, and you know, it's just a fun event. And in between, we have like social members night, and you know, just to have fun and meet people.
Yeah, I think it's great that these events are meant for like,
I think you should come.
Oh yes, I'll definitely check one of them out. But I think it's cool that it's meant for like a wide range, like of ages of people, from like children, students to faculty. So that's really cool to hear. And just one last question about these organizations. Do these communities collaborate at all with similar organizations that represent other ethnic groups in the U.S.?
I would really love to do it. As of now, we do have some joint events with Oil and Energy Association. Korean American oil, like the professionals who are in oil, like specifically in oil and gas industry, they have their own organization. So for this young generation forum, we work with them to have a joint event. But I'm actually talking to a few people who are involved in Italian American scientists or organization, and a Greek scientist organizations. My friends are involved, so I'm trying to, you know, get some information. Maybe we can have you know, just like a networking event. I think it'll be very fun things to do. So I'm thinking about it. Hopefully, hopefully we'll have a chance to do it. And other Asian, I'm not familiar. I know that there's a Chinese American association, and I was told that it's a very active. I haven't had a chance to talk to anyone who's involved in it, but it'll be nice to, you know, just have a social gathering event.
Yeah, that's awesome. I think it would be great to see more like global interactions between these communities.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah.
For our next question, we saw that you're involved in a flute choir. So could you tell us a little bit more about that and also any other hobbies that you have?
I've been playing flute since I was in fifth grade, so I was 10. That was a very good hobby that was forced upon. It was my mom's idea. I wanted to learn cello. I love cello. But my mom thought that I was too old to start a cello. My mom had a big vision, I think. She never explicitly said it, but I think she was hoping one of her daughters would pursue music as a career. So we all learned different instruments. I played flute, my younger sister plays the violin, my youngest sister plays the cello. So I mean I liked it, but I didn't want to practice because I had schools and stuff, but things, you know, really changed when we came to the States, because I was in band class. For 90 minutes, we were playing music. We had concerts 3 times a year, and I was part of marching band, and it was just fun. And then I continued, and I brought my flute. I took my flute to college with me, and then I played for fun. At the time, I wasn't really involved in anything. Then when I moved to Houston, I used to play flute at the temple event in Chicago. Then here, I wanted to join the Texas Medical Center Orchestra. When I first moved here, I saw them performing at the Methodist Hospital lobby area. It's like, I want to play with the orchestra. How fun would that be? Then, you know, like orchestra, you only need like 3 flute players max.
Yeah.
And I didn't think that I would make the cut. So I gave up on that. Then I shouldn't say person. She's now a friend. But when I met her, it's completely different event. But somehow we were talking about the oversized t-shirt. Oh, it was a science and engineering fair that she recruited me as a volunteer, because I love judging at the science fair because it's so fun. So they were giving us an oversized t-shirt. It was only one XL or large size. So we're just talking about, you know, commenting on the size of t-shirt. And she said, oh, I'm just going to give it to my daughter for her marching band practice. It's like, oh, yeah, I used to wear oversized t-shirt for my marching band camp. I said, well, what instrument do you play? I played flute. I have a flute choir. Do you want to come play with us?
Oh.
So that's how I was recruited to the Shimmer Flute Choir. So Donna, who's the director, so she invited me, and then I've been playing with them since then. I think that was 2016.
Oh, wow.
So we rehearse every other weekend, and we have concerts throughout the year, different themes. Yeah, Donna's faculty at U of H.
Oh.
Yeah, so it's really fun. We play, we perform at retirement communities. For Christmas, it's always fun. And we used to play at the Chapel Hill Historic Museum. historic museum of Chapel Hill or something like that. We used to play there. We haven't been there in a few years, and COVID changed a lot because, you know, flute is not very COVID friendly instrument. But yeah, we started again, and we had very fun concerts last year that was very well received. So we have themes, like space themed we had last year, and then caffeinated themed concert. So all the music we played were coffee related, coffee or tea. It was so fun. Yeah.
That's awesome. So are the members of this flute choir mostly like people in the science field as well, or is it just general?
All over. Yeah. All over the discipline. We have a retired lawyer. I mean, there are music directors, like professional musicians as well, but we have engineers, students. Yeah, it's very, very broad.
Yeah,
background.
That's awesome. As our final question, if you could go back in time and give a piece of advice to your younger self, what would it be?
Oh, that's a good question. Work a little hard. Have some discipline. I really enjoyed my youth. I mean, I did what I had to do. I mean, I, you know, I was being a good Asian student. I was getting good grades. I did what I was supposed to do. But if I could go back in time, I would like to, you know, tell myself to be a bit more disciplined. Just learn how to be more responsible. Yeah, because I think it's better if you have that experience from the early on. I believe that I had a very privileged childhood or life in general. So I didn't really think about all that until I was an adult, like semi-adult. So it would have been, I think my life would have been different if I were a little more responsible and kept some discipline.
I see. All right, I think that's all the questions we had. So thank you so much for the interview today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. This was fun.
Yeah, for sure.
I enjoyed it. Yeah. But do you have any like questions? Just not the ones that in the list, but do you have any questions?
I don't know. Did anything just come up that you wanted to share but maybe didn't get a chance to?
Well, I wanted to ask your backgrounds. Like, what do you guys study, and how long have you been at Rice?
Sure. I'm a sophomore here. I'm studying social policy analysis and English.
I'm a freshman at Rice. I'm studying neuroscience and hopefully a minor in Asian studies. I'm originally from Seattle, but I also lived in Korea throughout my elementary school years.
Oh, wow. So how do you guys feel about, you know, being Asian American? Like what it means to you?
To think about it. Yeah. So I was born here in the United States, but then I also moved to India for just a few years of my elementary school experience. And that was honestly like some of the most fun I ever had in my childhood. I loved being there so much. I feel like the culture definitely did feel different in India versus here growing up. I feel like I just had so much like community and like in my own neighborhood. I feel like I could go outside and play with the kids all the time. Whereas in America, I don't know. I just didn't see kids playing outside where I lived as much, but maybe that's just where I was.
That's interesting.
It was just very community oriented in India, I feel like.
Yeah, I mean, that's what it was like when I was growing up in Korea. Like, I played with neighbors' kids outside, but I don't think that's the case nowadays in Korea.
Yeah, very similar for me as well. Like what you mentioned earlier, I remember having like Saturday half days, and after the half days, we would just go to the playground and play and things. So I say I have like really sweet memories from childhood in Korea. But when I first moved to the States, I would say it was pretty difficult because of the language barrier and just the cultural difference. But I think over time, I really came to appreciate like the bicultural aspect of my identity and how I'm able to like fully understand both cultures and kind of like utilize it in like favorable ways. So I'm very thankful for that.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I didn't really care much about that, you know? Like I was just and I'm just an individual. I don't want to be identified as Korean or American. I didn't choose like I didn't appreciate that very much. Like I didn't understand why we're labeling ourselves as Korean or Korean American. Like why can't we just be who we are, you know? So that was really the thing, especially in college and even in high school. Like I didn't go out of my way to make Korean friends because there were other options. Like I'd rather, you know, make friends with other people from different parts of the world. So that was my mindset throughout the college. So all my friends from college, they're, you know, they're non-Korean, non-American. You know, they're all foreign nationals. In grad school as well, there weren't that many Koreans in grad school, especially in the discipline that I was in. So most of my friends were Indians, and I mean there were a lot of Indians and Chinese in grad school. So I was friends with them, and there were a few people from, you know, South America and some European countries in Africa. But it wasn't until I came to Houston, because, you know, being in Houston was the first time I was really on my own. I was far away from my sisters. You know, I was only one in Houston. My sisters before, when I was in Indiana, they were like 2 hours away from me, so I could drive over the weekend, go see them, but I was like really alone, alone. And not that I missed having that or just being part of the Korean community. It was just fun. I found it somewhat liberating, you know, just talking the same language and we eat the same food, and it was just fun. And that's how I got involved in this Korean American communities. But I have no like ambition of, you know, making a huge big dent in the Korean community. Like I don't really care for that. Maybe they wouldn't appreciate hearing this, but but I'm doing this because I'm having fun with other people. But and really, I grew being more appreciative, especially nowadays is really good time to be Korean. Like people are so interested in Korean culture, Korean food, so I'm you know really riding it.
I feel like Korean film has also been so huge. Like I've really getting
Yeah,
more of
for
that.
sure. So I think that, you know, right now we have something good going on. So I think it's fun. That's why I want to collaborate with other ethnic groups, associations, just to, 'cause it, you know, I mean, I like hanging out with Koreans, but I also like hanging out with non-Koreans. And I think that we need that exposure. I mean, after all, we live in the States. Like, if we want to, you know, just focus on being Korean and, you know, while that's great, then what's the point of living in Houston, where it's so diverse? So, yeah, that's what I think. Oh, well, I'm not going to take any more of your time, but thank you so much.
This
was
is so
fun.
Lovely. Yeah, this was our first interview, and it's just been such a great experience. I've enjoyed it so much, too.
I was, like, sweating.
We
questions.
Can
I don't...
No, it was wonderful.
Yeah. Oh, well, great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Have
Bye.
Have a nice day.
You
Thank
too.
You.
Bye.
Bye.
And best of luck to you.
Thank
you.
Both of you. Bye.